Bless the Lord. I ask you to rest on your feet just for a moment in reverence to the word of God. Thank you, Lord, for your word. St. Matthew 16, 13 through 20. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, Elias, and others Jeremias, or one of the prophets." He saith unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Jesus the Christ. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading and the hearing of his word. You may be seated.
Amen.
Glory to God. Glory to God. We thank God for his word and thank God for the presence of his power even in our midst. The Bible says that where two or three are gathered, he said, "I'm in the midst." And even if it's one, God is yet present because God is omnipresent. He's everywhere all the time. He doesn't have to wait to get there. He doesn't have to show up by the time you get there. God is always present. But I might use for a word this morning, and we thank the Lord because his word is so right. That's why the word of God is so necessary, and God determines that we not only read his word, but study his word and meditate over it. I would use a word this morning would be, "Who am I? Who am I?" Jesus asked many questions, but on this one occasion in our text, he asked him a question. Basically, who do you think I am? Who am I? Jesus, towards the end of his earthly ministry, he would always seek out people and to check out their attitudes and check out their reasoning as to why they followed him. He would often question them whether they were Pharisees, Sadducees, or even disciples, or maybe even somebody by the road. It didn't matter whether they sat at his feet or yelled across the street. He wanted to know where their loyalties lie. He would always ask them one question, even when they would confront him. "What do you want from me? Or what would you have me to do?" Jesus was very personable. He wasn't someone who didn't want to be around people. Jesus was very personable, and he would make every attempt to make it known as to his presence, as to why he was even in the place. And I'm glad about that. I'm glad God is not in a box. I'm glad he's not in a corner. But the Bible says that the earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, and the world, and they that dwell therein. So Jesus was very obvious and very evident and always made himself known when it was time to bring forth something or speak something. He was always in the right place at the right time. And I'm glad about that. I'm glad about God is like that, that when I need him the most, or when I need him at all, he's always present. Yeah. What a mighty God we serve. As Jesus, toward the end of his earthly ministry, and he knew it was about time to offer himself up, he was drawing closer to his disciples, and he was letting them know the end was near for the earthly part, and that he was trying to put them at peace, and so that they wouldn't be at odds one with another when he left them. I'm so glad that the Lord always has a calming word and a word to kind of settle you down. You ever been seem like you can't make ends meet, or you're at odds even with yourself, and the word of God, just the Lord is my shepherd, is enough to calm you down. Well, the Lord was in somewhat of a mode to encourage his disciples and let them know that even though he was leaving them, he wasn't going to leave them helpless and hopeless, but rather he was going to leave them with some peace. I'm glad God gives peace. Glory to God. I'm glad he gives peace, because in the midst of tribulation, in the midst of testing, and in the midst of not knowing, I need some peace in the situation. I remember a couple weeks ago, I was thinking about something, and the Lord brought the occasion when Jesus was walking on the water. And when he was walking on the water, and he had gotten to the boat, and there was still a lot of rumbling, the waves, the wind, and all he spoke was peace. Yeah. Basically, he said, peace be still. He didn't say, stop wind. He didn't say, stop waves. He just said, peace. He spoke peace. And I'm glad that God is God enough that he does have the command over everything, that he can just, glory to God, he can just speak peace in my situation. And peace, listen, will take place. I'm glad about that. That's the kind of God that we serve. And so our Lord was trying to leave his disciples with some peace, because he knew that the time was coming that they would be disbanded. They would be almost running for their lives, hiding out like criminals. So they needed to know that God was able to bring what he had said to pass.
Amen.
What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. As the Lord's popularity, as Christ became more popular and his fame grew, so did the persecution, and so did the conspiracy against him grow. And Jesus needed to know, and he knew all things, but the humanity of Christ needed to know who was loyal, who was with him, who would stand with him. Now, he knew it as being God, but his humanity and the pain he was about to suffer, he needed to know, are you with me? Have you ever gone into a situation or a circumstance and you turn to the one beside you or on either side of you and you say, are you with me? Are you going to stand with me? He needed to know who was loyal. He needed to know, amen, how everything was going to turn out. The Bible says when he came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi in St. Matthew 16 and 13, he said, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Now, when Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man, it was basically a term of humanity, because not only was he the Son of God, which reflects his divinity, but he was the Son of Man. He was both God and man. So he said, what does the humanity say about me? I know who I am because I am God, but what is the word on me? Now, I thank God that he was both God and man, and he was born of a virgin, but he was begotten, listen, but begotten, and he existed forever, eternally. So he was both God and man, but he was begotten of God and existed forever. So he said, basically, what is the word on me? What are they saying about me? What do they think about me? What is the report? What do they say about me? Now, the interesting part, if God cannot convince you that he's God, you're going to struggle with believing. If God is not God and nothing less, you're going to struggle with believing. If your God has become a man, you're going to struggle with believing. Even though he was the God-man, he was yet God of the universe. Everything held together, Bible says, by the word of his mouth. So therefore, he just wanted to know during this time of crisis, what are they saying about me?
Amen.
What's the word on me? You know, Daniel speaks of the Ancient of Days, which is still referencing the Son of Man, because Revelation speaks of the Ancient of Days, Daniel speaks of the Ancient of Days, because we're speaking of someone who is God eternally existing forever. And the only one that ever existed forever was God. And the Bible says, in the beginning, God. Not that God was created, because God always existed.
Amen.
So Jesus, even though he showed up in a virgin's womb, always existed. God, man. Glory to God. So therefore, the humanity part, the part that existed on earth for over 33 years, he wanted to know, what are they saying about me? Who do they say I am? How efficient have I done my job? What have they said about me? And then in the 14th verse, and they said, some say that thou art John the Baptist. Some say Elias or Jeremiah or one of the prophets. And then he turns to Peter and he said to them, but who say ye that I am? Looking at the disciples as well as to Peter and saying, I understand what folk are saying about me, but who do you say I am? Who am I? What do I mean to you? Who do you see me as? Now, what is interesting is John the Baptist was already dead. He had already been beheaded. And some thought John the Baptist had rose from the dead and maybe Jesus. And so Peter says, some said, you're John the Baptist. Now that couldn't be the case because John had already been beheaded and the ministry of Christ began to take full swing after John the Baptist went off the scene. See, John was not the light, but he was a messenger representing the light. And when he went off the scene, then the light shone brightly without any distraction from John. So therefore, it couldn't have been John the Baptist because John was already dead. And then he said, well, maybe you're one of the prophets, Jeremiah or Elias. Now, Jeremiah and Elias were prophets who had already gone off the scene. Jeremiah had died, but Elias was taken up, or Elijah was taken up into heaven by a chariot. A chariot came out. God sent a chariot from heaven to dispatch his prophet Elijah into heaven. So John is dead from being beheaded. Jeremiah died, but Elijah was yet alive in the presence of God because God sent a chariot to retrieve him to heaven. So there's no way in the world Jesus could have been any of them that they spoke of. So really, hearsay is not sufficient to warrant us to be faithful in something that doesn't back itself up by fact. And Jesus said, wait a minute, who do you say I am? You can't tell me you heard about me and act as if that's enough value to say who I am. See, in order to believe who he is, you got to know who he is. I was looking at this, and as I was looking down in my text, I thought about it. I said, Lord, I said, they had already been with you almost 3 years. There shouldn't have been any doubt in their mind who he was. Because you had talked with him, you seen the miracles, you saw the persecution, you saw God in his splendor, you saw the presence of God on your behalf. How could you confuse the fact that he might be John the Baptist who was dead? How could you confuse the fact that he was one of the old prophets who had since long gone off the scene?
Amen.
Who am I? As I was looking at this, my eyes fell on a scripture here, because Jesus is at the close of his ministry in our gospel here, but Jesus was still about the work of healing, blessing, and reaching the lives of the multitude. And people followed for a lot of reasons. Some folk follow the Lord just for food because they think he's just a food bag. Some folk follow the Lord for just money because they think he's just a bank. Now, I said, Lord, how could they even open their mouth and say John the Baptist? Because some of the disciples, I believe it was either Andrew or Philip, were disciples of John. How in the world could you believe that when you already know that the other master had been beheaded? Now, as I was looking at this, my eyes turned to, I'm right here, the same in Matthew 15 and 29. I said, Lord, how in the world could they conclude John the Baptist or one of the other prophets that had already died, or at least gone off the scene?
Yes.
I'm imagining that Jesus said, are you kidding? How could I be them? But I look at this, and it says in the 29th verse of the 15th chapter of St. Matthew, and Jesus departed from thence and came nigh on the Sea of Galilee and went into a mountain and sat down. And most of the time, Jesus would separate himself from the crowds and the multitude to pray and commune with the Father. Now, look what it says here. And great multitudes came unto them. Now, here he is trying to get some alone time. And multitudes, I don't know how big a multitude is, but a multitude would have to be bigger than 5,000 folk. Because when you reference 5,000 folk that followed Jesus for the food or came and Jesus fed 5,000, they still talk about the multitude, but in reality it was actually 20,000 people counting the women and the children. So it would have to be more than 5,000 folk, but these folk are constantly thronging him, pressing him, and seeking him out. Now here he is trying to be by himself. Now I look at this motivation here. And great multitudes came unto him, having with them those that were lame, blind, dumb, maimed, and many others, and cast them down at Jesus' feet, and he healed them. No way he could have been John the Baptist. John came baptizing. John came with a word that the light was to come, and yet they brought the sick, the lame, the blind, the halted, the mute, and laid them at the feet of Jesus. And the Bible said he healed them.
Yes.
In so much, now this blows my mind here. He says, in so much that the multitude wondered when they saw the dumb to speak, and maimed to be whole, the lame to walk, and the blind to see, and they glorified the God of Israel. Maybe some folk are still wondering who Jesus is. Maybe I really don't know who he is, I just wonder about him. We used to sing a song in church, "Don't Wonder About Him." God will work a wonder, don't wonder about him. They seemingly followed him for the miracles and still did not acknowledge him as God. Multitudes followed him and fell at his feet and still did not see him as the Christ. Now our Lord asked the question to his disciples, who do you say I am? I got multitudes following me and falling at my feet, and they're still wondering who I am.
Amen.
You would think they'd be convinced that he is the Messiah. You would think they'd be convinced that nobody else would have such a repertoire and such a, listen, such a following for and an attitude and a responsibility and be before God as he was before God and not be God. And yet they wondered.
Yes.
And the Bible said they glorified the God of Israel, but they still didn't know who Jesus was. Now, after all this, he asked his disciples, what are they still talking about? Lord, they still think you're John the Baptist. They still think you're one of the prophets. They still think. He said, but what do you think about me? Who am I? What do you think? What do you think? The knowledge of God can't be based on hearsay, but it must be the fact of the Word of God backed up by faith.
Yes.
Got to be the Word of God backed up by faith. Backed up by faith. I must know in whom I have believed. God, before time, spoke his prophetic word about who he was. The Bible says in Hebrews 1:1, God, who at sundry times or different times and in different manners, diverse manners, spake in times past unto the fathers by the prophets. God spoke through Moses. God spoke through Noah. God spoke through Abraham. God spoke through Joshua. God spoke through all the prophets, David, before time. But the Bible says, listen, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom he hath made the world. All them that have come before were really a precursor to the one that would come, the Christ.
Amen.
Ooh, glory. He said, yeah, he spoke through the prophets. He spoke through his word. But now he's speaking through his Son. Glory to God. Who am I? You're the God. God is a spirit. He's a spirit. Can't be seen. Can't be felt. But must be believed and received. Even though you sense, even though you feel the presence of God, you're actually sensing the presence of God because God is a spirit. And your spirit is in tune with his spirit, therefore you sense the presence of God. Glory to God. And yet they didn't know they were in the presence of God. Glory to God. When God speaks, it is God breathed. Every time God opens his mouth, he breathes. He speaks, but it's the breath of God through the word of God, through the presence of God, that is ours, known by the sensing of the Spirit of God. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, listen, all scripture, all word, all scripture is given by the inspiration of God. God said, everything I speak in my word, I breathed it. I breathed it. And now you're before my Son who spoke it, and you still don't know who he is. Glory. It must have been quite embarrassing for the Son of Man to get a reply that you may be John the Baptist. The Bible says all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfectly, thoroughly furnished unto all good work. Jesus told the woman at the well in the 4th chapter of St. John, he said, God is a spirit, and therefore he had to be worshipped in spirit and in truth. If the truth of God is to set you free, it must be God breathed. God speaks it. When God speaks it and breathes it, it's the same thing. It sets you free. Matthew 16 and 15. Then he saith unto him, But whom say ye that I am? When he spoke to the disciples. And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art, who am I? Thou art the Christ. Even though the arguments say what hearsay said, Peter steps up and said, Thou art the Christ. You got to see him as the Christ, the Son of the living God. Glory to God. No doubt, no question. You're it, God. And Jesus' reply to Peter, he said, Blessed thou art, or blessed art thou, Simon Barjona. For flesh and blood, because the Spirit of God, or truth of God's word, is God breathed. He said, flesh and blood didn't reveal this to you. You didn't get this through your feeling. You didn't get this through your touch. You didn't get this through your senses. He said, but understand this. He said, flesh and blood didn't reveal it unto you, but my Father which is in heaven. In other words, what you just got was God breathed. And therefore, the truth will not only make you free, but the truth will set you free. When I know who he is, he will set me free by the power of his word and the power of his voice. God can speak. That's why God can speak into existence. What? Not only creation, but God can speak into existence all that he stands in need of. There's no limitation to what God can do. God can do it because he is God. Glory. Peter made a strong declaration that Christ was the Son of the living God. Throughout the ministry of Christ, his disciples had to be inspired by Christ to know that he is God. Do you remember reading in the Gospels, oftentimes they would say that they marveled at what was done? You remember when Jesus took Peter, James, and John on the Mount of Transfiguration, and they saw Elijah and Moses all transfigured before them, and the Bible says that Peter spoke up and said, Lord, let's make some tabernacles here. Let's make some kind of offering, because what I'm seeing, I know has to be of God. And basically, a voice from heaven says, basically, be quiet, be still, hear my son. Don't you say a thing. You're in the presence of God. God is breathing right now. He's talking right now. It's his place to speak and your place to be silent. Who am I? Thou art the Christ, glory to God, the Son of the living God. And once we know that, and once we receive that, then all power in heaven and earth is at our disposal because we know who he is.
Thank you.
Glory to God. Glory. Look at this now. Look at this now. The Lord often had to stir the disciples' consciousness and let them know, I got to keep you on track because what I'm doing is for your benefit and for my purpose because I'm God. He had to stir up Thomas and Philip. In St. John 14 and 5, he said, Thomas saith unto him, when Jesus said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we don't know where you're going. He said, how can we know the way? And Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And then the Lord says, if you had known me, you should have known the Father. My Father also, and from henceforth you know him and have seen him. In other words, you got to know me. Then Philip says, Lord, he said, show us. Let me see something, let me feel something, let me taste something, let me smell something. He said, show us the Father, and it satisfies or suffices us. And then Jesus said, I've been with you a long time. I've been with you a long time. And he said, and listen, and thou hast not known me? Wait a minute, Philip. Did you think you just had a man speaking to you? God has been speaking to you almost 3 years, and you don't know that he is with you. speaks into your spirit is God breathed. So if it's God breathed and you heard it, God has been speaking all along.
Amen.
You know, we say sometimes, something said something to me. We know what something said something to me. I don't even know what that is anymore. But when God speaks, he makes himself clear. He told him, listen, he that has seen me has seen the Father, and how sayest thou, show me the Father. Our knowing Christ, glory to God, who Christ is developed through intimacy, amen, and association. As we draw near to him, we're able more and more to discern his voice. In other words, understand, listen, and give in to his voice and know who he is. And then the Lord drops a real bombshell on Peter. He says, listen, Peter, because of what you said and because of what my Father has revealed to you, that I am the living Christ, he said that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, or upon this knowledge of me, the church was not built upon Peter, but the church was built upon Christ. Christ is the chief cornerstone. But he said, Peter, the nugget of truth that has been God breathed to you and revealed to you by the Spirit of God, he said, upon that truth I will build my church. He said, and the gates of hell itself shall not prevail against that truth, because the fact is, you know now who I am.
Amen.
Because you know who I am, then you can access the power that only belongs to me. So in the name of Jesus, demons have to tremble.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus,
yes.
Power's got to come under some things.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus, things got to take place, because there's no other authority that's higher. Once you know who he is.
Once you know.
Look at this now. He told him, Peter, he said, because of what you know, it matters what you know, beloved.
Yeah.
And if you know Jesus, he said, I've given you the keys, and any key that you have in the natural always opens up a door, or a door of opportunity. He said, I give you the keys. Oh, listen now. He said, I give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound, because you know this truth of who I am. Because you stand in the truth of my word and claim your promise according to my name,
yes.
The scripture says, whatsoever you desire, whatever you stand in need of, that if you ask in the name of Jesus,
yes.
All heaven takes notice.
Yes.
All hell takes notice.
Yes.
The earth has to respond to the word of God when we believe in who Jesus is. Look what he says here. I love this. He said, bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Thank God for the connection between heaven and earth. Amen. Because God says, when I take authority by his word, according to the power of Christ, with whom I believe, I can take authority over my earthly stuff. And heaven takes notice and gives me power to bring it to pass.
Amen.
So you got to know who he is. And once you know who he is, it unleashes the power, because it gives you the keys, the Bible says, to the kingdom. Keys to the power, keys to the authority. Keys not only to the power and authority, but to the responsibility that we have on earth. All power and authority is in the name of Christ. And when we know who he is, we know whose we are. Mm-hmm. When we know who he is, we know whose we are.
Yes.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Christ said of himself, glory to God, John 6:48, he said, I am the bread of life. That's who he is. He said he is the bread of life. No one needs to hunger after a thing. No one needs to long after anything else. Listen, his bread alone will satisfy what because he is the bread of life. The Bible says in St. John 8:12 that he is the light of the world. No need to walk in darkness. I can walk in the strength and the light of God's word. John 8:12 says, then spake Jesus again, saying unto them, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me, glory to God, thank God for the light, shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life.
Amen.
That's who he is, beloved. The bread of life, the light of the world. He also said he was the living water.
Yes.
John 4:14. But whosoever drinketh, glory to God, of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. Glory to God. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up unto everlasting life. That's who he is, beloved. He's the bread of life. Glory to God. He's the living water. And the Bible says, and this to show his divinity, he's the I am that I am.
Amen.
He always was and always has been. Exodus 3:14, God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thou shalt say unto the children of Israel, I am have sent me unto you.
Yes.
He always existed. Always has been. And we're going to follow that up. Revelation 1:18. The same reference of Christ is made of himself when he's showing John the revelation. In Revelation 1:8, he said, I am, glory to God. He said, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the ending, saith the Lord, which is and which is to come, which was and which is to come, the Almighty. Jesus said of himself in Revelation to John, he said, I'm the beginning and the end,
Amen.
The Alpha and the Omega.
Amen.
I am he that was come and I am here. I am all that will, glory to God, I am all that will come. I am he.
Amen.
Amen.
So all power, all authority is in our grasp when we believe that Christ is the Son, glory to God, of the living God.
Yes.
Whom do men say that I am?
My Lord.
He's not John the Baptist. He's not one of the prophets. He is the Christ. He is the living God. He is the bread of life. He is living water. Glory to God. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the first and the last. He's a wonderful counselor. He's a mighty God. He's a Prince of Peace. He's all that we need for whatever we need. Because in his name, glory to God. And because of who he is, I have the keys, the power, the authority, all the claim, what is mine, because I know who he is.
Amen.
Glory to God. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you.
I know who he is.
Amen.
He's not John. He's not Jeremiah. He's not Elias. But he's the Christ.
Thank you, Lord.
And because he is the Christ,
yes,
I can walk in faith, believing. He said, I am that I am. That literally means the self-sufficient one. Listen, I didn't exist because somebody made me. Christ said I existed because I always existed.
Yes.
I was not created. I've always been here. I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end.
Amen.
Who am I? He says, I'm Christ, the Son of the living God.